All right, so hey everybody, this is Tim, back again with a video. And in today's video, we're gonna talk about the five downsides to working for yourself. So I did a video a while back talking about five benefits to working for yourself. And in that video, I said I could probably also come up with plenty of downsides, which is what this video is gonna be. I know it's been a while, but now I got the whole nice new setup here, got the new recording equipment, got the lights now all set up in a sort of static place. So now it's gonna be a lot easier for me to just like turn on the camera and record a video like this, and it doesn't take a lot of time to sort of do the setup. So yeah, let's just go over sort of the downsides to working for yourself. Again, before I get started, I just want to say that I love working for myself. I would never do anything else, but there are definitely some downsides. So let's discuss. So I guess the first thing is just the sort of the business aspect of it. And I know this is just something that I found really difficult when I first got started, and I still find it pretty difficult sometimes. And by that, I kind of mean the sort of, if you're dealing with producers, like the people who sort of are in charge of the time, of the money, there are going to be times when they're going to try to push what they can get for what they're paying for. And what I mean by that is that, like, let's say you have a project and there is a deadline coming up, and they are certainly requesting a lot of changes to stuff that was already approved. Let's say you do a certain, you work on a shot, and there are like the animation was approved, the lighting was almost approved, and then they come back and then they say, yeah, okay, we want to change the animation, or we want to change this effect, even though it was already approved and a deadline is coming up. So if they still want to change it, even though they already approved all of that stuff, it means there's going to be extra work for you, extra time for you, and you might not be able to do it within a deadline. Now, they might say, okay, we can make a couple of extra days in order to, like, we can extend the deadline a little bit. All right, but still, that means extra work for you on something they have already seen. They might have already approved of it a week ago. So they already knew completely well what was up, like they've already seen it. So, and then they're still gonna ask you to maybe do it for the same amount of money. So in this case, you can kind of say, okay, you already approved this and I'm not gonna change it, which is probably not the nicest thing to do. But, or you can also say, okay, I can be a little bit forthcoming, like I can make these changes, but it's gonna cost you extra. Like, because we discussed the deliver date. This was gonna be the deliver date. You approved of this thing, like you saw this thing a couple of days ago, a week ago, everybody approved it, and now you suddenly want to change it. That is fine, but it's going to cost extra. A lot of times you actually find that then suddenly they're suddenly happy with what it is and they will just leave it, or they will be okay with you charging a little bit extra. But this is difficult, because you will need to be a little bit strict with that, and that's where sort of you need to learn to sort of be a little bit harder. Like, you cannot always be friendly. You need to be friendly, but you kind of need to be strict with stuff like that. And that can be difficult. And that is something that took me long to sort of be somewhat good at. And it's still difficult for me. But that is definitely a downside. The business aspect of it, and dealing with the business thing of it, and we're all artists, we love doing the work. Not everybody is as business minded. I am decently business minded. That's what something I've learned over the years. I wasn't good at that before, but this is something, definitely a downside, or it can be an upside if you like the business aspect. But, like, I know that for a lot of artists, this is just difficult. So now something that kind of plays into that, and that is, you are your own business, you are your own man. You can take up as much work as you want. You can, if you have enough clients, you can book yourself completely full and work 24-hour days. Which is kind of a pitfall that I really fell into when I was first working for myself. So you have to learn to sort of pace yourself, and that is can be a little bit difficult. At least, like for example, when you first start out, you're going to be inclined to just like take up all of the jobs because you never know, like when is the next job going to be there. So you're inclined to just like take up like a lot of work. And that can be like really difficult on yourself. And like that's so, like doing that is what led me to have a burnout a couple of years ago. I discussed that in an earlier video because I was just always saying yes to everything. I was taking up a lot of work and I always said like, well, I mean, I like my work. So why shouldn't I just do it all the time? But like still it's work and it's not good to do it all the time. And it's very easy to just get lost in that side of it. And you're going to need to be able to set boundaries, and that is definitely sort of a downside. It's just very easy to get into that. Like, let's say you do a client project, and let's say, like the previous example, there's going to be a delay into the next week, but you already booked another project that was going to start that week. In that case, what are you going to do? What I tend to do nowadays, and I'm not saying necessarily that this is the way to do it, but it's, I found that this works for me, is I try to not book client projects back to back, for example. I always try to keep time between client projects. And then if everything works out as intended, everything is done when it's supposed to be done, then I have extra time and then I can record stuff like tutorials, do all of that stuff. And if the client project, if everything goes completely wrong and there's delays and everything, well, then I have the extra time. So that's what I like to do. But this can be very just difficult to sort of really take this, just like to pace yourself in whatever it is you're doing. Just like try to set boundaries. It is work, even if you like it, try to pace yourself. And this is definitely a downside. It's really easy to overdo it. And also it can be difficult to sort of say no to clients because you might be afraid that they're not coming back. This is especially like when I first started out, I was really afraid to say no. And I would always just like take up every job, like every opportunity would come after me, I would just say yes. Until I burned out, but that taught me that like the burnout thing taught me that like I could just say no, because I was saying no all the time during the burnout. Like I didn't do any work for a couple of months and they still came back. So that showed me that it's not bad to say no. You can say no, it's fine. But it's something you definitely sort of need to learn, set boundaries and like know for yourself like what is possible. So another thing that kind of plays into that is also it's easy to sort of overpromise, and that's also a thing that's easy to fall into, especially if you're like, let's say you're not as experienced, you're like a mid-level artist and you have decent experience, like you know how to make shots, you know how to make deliverables, you've been doing this for a while. But like you're not like at like senior level yet where it's like easy enough, like you can make clear estimations of how much time everything costs. So in the beginning, you might like overpromise. You might think, all right, I am confident that this thing is gonna, like this shot is gonna take me 5 days. So you say, 5 days, all right. And then you start working on it, and then it just there's a lot of stuff that you didn't foresee, and there's just a lot of issues that you run into, and then the 5 day, you're still gonna like need to put it in the time that you step, but it's gonna be super long days and it's just like not ideal. So what I found for myself is like I know that I always underestimate stuff, so I always add some time on top of like what I think. Like, let's say I think it's 5 days, then it's gonna, so if I think it's gonna be like 5 days of work, then I'm gonna say it's 6 or 7 days of work, because I know that I underestimated. Initially that I thought that was difficult to do, because it's like when you're like talking to a producer or like to your client, it might seem unfair to sort of charge more than you think that it's gonna take. But from experience, I just know that it's always gonna take a little bit longer, and there's always gonna be more client feedback. Maybe sometimes, you might be lucky and everything goes completely smoothly, but it's good to sort of calculate it into. And I mean, as long as the client sort of approves the budget, then it's also okay on their side. Apparently, it's worth this. Like, they can get their money back from this. So don't feel bad about that. Like, that's what budgeting is about, right? Like, they ask you for something, you make an estimation, you also take sort of a gamble, because there also might be downside. Like, you always need to factor in that there might be extra work. So one time you will sort of spend a little bit extra. Sometimes it will go smoothly and you'll make that time back. But in general, it's good to sort of calculate in like a little bit of estimation. And so that's what I kind of do to sort of avoid the overpromising thing. And again, like the overpromising, I guess that also happens inside of like studios. Like if you're talking to your producer, you're like, I can do that. Like, it's going to be easy. No problem. I can do all of that. But when you're working for yourself and your rates are, of course, going to be higher, there's going to be more expected of you. You're going to need to, like, if something goes wrong, you are on the hook sort of a little bit more than if you were inside of studio. So yeah, that's, I guess, another downside. So another thing that I really, 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 really don't like, and I know I mentioned this as a sort of as a benefit in my previous video, and that's taxes. So in the previous video, I mentioned it as a benefit because you can expense everything that you buy for your company, like this fancy new microphone that I bought. This is a tax expense because I use it for work. Like, this is part of my work. YouTube channel is also part of my work, which is nice. But just doing taxes is just, like, if you thought it was bad, just like doing your personal income tax, just wait until you work for yourself. It can depend. Like, it doesn't have to be too bad. But like, if I take myself as an example, like, I don't only do client work for like just like companies in the Netherlands. I also work with international clients. Sometimes I have done invoices in dollars, so I have to deal with the currency difference, because I have to report taxes in euros and I have to deal with dollars, so I have to do the currency conversion thing. I buy software in dollars sometimes. I get invoices in dollars. You need to do all of the currency conversion stuff. You need to account for everything, because if the tax man comes, they want to be able to make sure that you paid your fair share of taxes. Here, you need to like link up your, like, at least in my tax packages I use, like, you need to link up all my bank statements to all of the invoices. And again, also for me, it makes it a little bit different because I don't only do client projects. I also sell courses on Gumroad. I have Patreon income. And like, all of that just makes my tax situation a lot more complicated. And it always just takes so much time to do everything. Also, like in Netherlands, we usually use like debit cards. So you generally pay with debit card, but I also have credit cards. But credit cards, I cannot link them directly to the thing, like I mentioned. Like, I need to link everything up. So I need to link the credit card, but I need to go into the credit card payment and check all of the transactions in there. Then I need to split up the thing, link it separately. And I have a great accountant who I can call if I get stuck with things. And I'm really thinking of just handing off more of that work to her, because it's really just I don't like the tech side of it. I just wanna like do my work. I like the business aspect of it. Like, I like making courses, selling courses. I like dealing, like doing client work. Like, I like that side of the business, but I really don't like the tech side of it. And really, if you're working your own business, it's the tech side is a lot more work than than just doing your personal income tax. So again, there are also benefits, like everything is a tax expense, like all of the stuff you buy for your work is a write-off, like this YouTube channel or the courses I make is also part of my business. So everything I do for that as well is a tax expense. So that is a huge benefit. Pros and cons, but tax, doing the tech stuff is really something I really don't like about the being self-employed part. But again, pros and cons. So another thing that for me personally is, I guess, somewhat of an upside, but I can understand for some people this is a downside, and this will also depend on the part of the world that you're in. But it is saving for retirement or saving for sick leave and like doing all of your budgeting yourself. So it depends on where you are in the world. I know in the United States, all of that stuff is pretty much already left up to everybody to sort like save for your own retirement, like put money in Roth IRA, etc., etc. In the Netherlands, if you have a full-time job, you automatically pay into retirement and all of that stuff. If you work for yourself, you have to do it yourself, which is something I see like a lot of people just like don't do it, because over here it's just not something inherently that you're taught that you need to do that. But in the US that's probably different, because everybody just needs to do it themselves anyway. But over here, I know so many people who work for themselves who don't do anything for retirement. They just leave their money in their bank account, which will of course devalue quite a lot because of inflation, and they don't do anything. Like I know people who are like in their 40s who haven't saved up anything for retirement, which is like a little bit problematic. I really like personal finance stuff. I really like the FIRE. If you don't know, if you know about the FIRE movement, stands for financially independent retire early. That is something that I'm a huge proponent of. I'm saving for early retirement, and like I really like being able to sort of manage my own finances and just like have it in my own control, the amount of money I save, like when I will maybe be able to retire, etc., etc. But I understand that this is not the case for everybody. Managing all this stuff is a skill in itself, and that can be quite difficult. And I understand that for some people it might be just easier to like if you just have a full-time job in the Netherlands, you just pay for retirement by yourself. Once you retire, you know what you're gonna get. Easy as that. I like having my own control. By the way, if you want me to do sort of a video, I guess more about the financial aspect of it. I know that's not necessarily I guess that's part of the business. But if you want me to do a video about that, anyway, like I'm doing a sort of a private thing for some friends soon in Discord, where I'm talking about with another friend about sort of investing for retirement. So I'm gonna have some of that prepared anyway. So maybe if you'd like to see that on YouTube as well, I could do similar thing on YouTube. Like, of course, I'm not a financial advisor, but I figured that might be interesting to also discuss on the channel, like what the possibilities are for saving for retirement or even early retirement if you're working for yourself. Anyway, that is, I guess, also a either downside or upside. If depending on how you look at it. Right, so just to recap, I guess. First downside is that you kind of need to be a little bit more business minded. You need to be a little bit more strict, which is not something that everybody likes to do. Second downside is that if you have your own business, it's very easy to overdo it, to just like work all the time and just take way too much of your plate. So that's a definite second one. And that's something I burned myself out doing too much. So the third thing is overpromising. It's very easy to overpromise, especially if you're more junior, mid-level. Like you never, like it's going to be hard to sort of completely estimate what you are able to do. And you learn with time, the longer you do this, what you are able to do, what your skill, what you're good at, what you're bad at. So that's also a definite downside. The fourth one was tax. So I guess the like death and taxes are unavoidable, unfortunately. And the fifth one, retirement. Again, it's a benefit for me being able to sort of save for my own retirement and like manage my own finances, like cover my own risk of getting sick. It's like, it's like I mentioned before, like I had a burnout where I couldn't work for almost a year. I had saved money in order, like if something like that were to happen. But I can understand, like if someone I lived super frugally for a year in order to be able to do that. So I can understand that like not everybody likes that idea of needing to be able to sort of do that yourself. So anyway, those were the five downsides to working for yourself. Again, I just want to also reiterate that I absolutely love working for myself. I would never want to work a full-time job for a boss in a studio ever. But I thought it would be good to sort of also point out these five downsides. If you haven't seen the first video, link to that is in the description. If you like this video, leave this a thumbs up. If you didn't like it, leave it a thumbs down. If you want to see more videos, so tutorials, business videos like this, subscribe and hit the bell icon. And again, let me know if you want to see more of these, I guess, more businessy videos, maybe talking about the monetary aspects of it. And I guess I will see you in the next one. Peace.